cheer from the audience. Oh, yeah. Calm down, calm down. All right. Now, let's begin tonight's episode of Admiral Pizza Live. Tonight's guest is Betz, and he's on the other line here. All right, Betz, why don't you give everybody a nice hello?
Hello, everybody. It is I, Betz. I'm here.
Yes, and we couldn't be happier. Last time we tried to have you on the show, but we're having some technical difficulties with the Irish-Chinese anti-pizza coalition. They like to interrupt our broadcasts and gum up things. But we got some pretty good cybersecurity and pepperoni pizza helping us out. So tonight's broadcast should go very smoothly. Hopefully tonight we will also have the guy who does Saint Centurion, and we'll get his name when he gets on live here. So, yeah. So, All right. So what do you want to talk about tonight? Well, I think before the broadcast earlier, we were talking a little bit about Mountain Dew. So, you were talking about this Mountain Dew. I don't know if this could actually bring up an interesting discussion. I don't know if the Mountain Dew that you got may be regional, like it's a regional thing, like you can't get it in some areas. But currently the Mountain Dew that I'm drinking, that I'm is my go-to poison, is the Mountain Dew Voltage, with charged with raspberry, citrus flavor, and ginseng, and other natural quote-unquote flavors.
So one of the things that I do in my off time, and you know, when I'm not drawing comics and when I'm not at work, is I collect Mountain Dew and like limited edition soda flavors. So right now I have a collection of all the limited edition sodas from this past summer. I also have the elusive Mountain Dew Flaming Hot, which is a spicy Mountain Dew. I've got a bottle of Voltage and whatnot. I have them like a little shelf. But the one that I'm sipping on tonight, and the one that I was mentioning to you before the show, is Mountain Dew Gingerbread Snaps. And it is due with a blast of artificial gingerbread flavor. And surprisingly, no, it is not regional. I just got access to it early because my Walmart was nice enough to put like 40 boxes of it on the shelf and not realize that the release date wasn't until like November. So you'll probably get access to it at some point later in the towards Christmas season, but it's very good. If you like gingerbread houses and stuff like that, like gingerbread cookies, you're gonna love this.
I see. So gingerbread families, you know, they come with like the little gingerbread man, the gingerbread wife, and the gingerbread children. I mean, me personally, I always eat the gingerbread children because I figure the gingerbread adults can just make more gingerbread people, so it's not much of a loss, right?
Oh my god.
I mean...
Jeez.
What? I'm just trying to be... I'm just trying to be somewhat ethical here, you know?
I mean, you could probably, they can make more, but like, you know, like, if you eat the parent, you could have a gingerbread Batman. Like, you gotta weigh both pros and cons here. Like,
I eat the gingerbread children, so I don't want any gingerbread Batman, so.
You don't want a little cape crusader flying around protecting your home city of,
every orphan can has the luxury of being Batman. It's very expensive, so, I mean, maybe not all orphans want to be Batman. Maybe some of them want to be Green Lantern. Wonder Woman, right?
Those guys aren't orphans.
Well, I know, but maybe they orphans want. They don't have. Maybe Batman doesn't have to own the orphan market. You know?
Are you telling me Batman owns orphans now? He hoards them.
I don't know. He goes through so many Robins.
Oh my god! Yes, he does. Did you see the new Batman trailer, Admiral?
The new Batman show or Batman trailer?
The new trailer with the guy from Twilight in it.
No, I haven't yet. You know what? If we were a luxury talk show, we'd be able to bring up a clip right about now and talk about it, couldn't we?
We would be able to.
Yeah.
It's true.
Yeah. Well, it sucks because one of my guests, they brought a clip for from their movie, and they're like, "Can I play it?" And I'm like, "No."
What guest had a movie?
I don't know. He's just joking. He's just.
Oh, I was about to say, I was like, is there somebody out there being more successful? Is this the next Spears guy? Is he gonna be the? Is he making a movie and not telling anybody?
Well, I don't know. Someone's always has their big project. You know, be it a movie or a comic. So, okay, so speaking of projects, you are the creator of Terrifull, the webcomic, mm-hmm. which you have been doing for how long?
More seriously, about a year. If you want to get really technical, I've been doing it since I was 13, so almost 10 years ago.
Oh, wow, so let's get a clap from the audience there.
Thank you.
Time to do a comic. Yeah, no, I've been working.
Yeah.
Admiral Pizza was conceived in the year 2008 with my kid cousin, who'd come over on Mondays and we'd watch Adventure Time and cook pizza, and he would like doodle these little stories of Admiral Pizza. And one day, he left his sketchbook. And I just completed the story, and he was like, "Oh, this is really cool." And so we just did like these little doodles, and every Monday we'd just work on the story. And then one day we finally compiled a book, which was issue one, or like a little like colored story, which was issue one. And then in time came, we did issue two, and then issue three, and then, you know, he grew up, but. I just decided to keep the tradition going and just kept doing them. So, yeah, and that's, well, I mean, I tried to do other things like Zan and Eddie, but everyone just wanted more Admiral Pizza stories, and the Admiral delivers, and so the people get what they wanted.
Can't blame them. You know, Admiral Pizza is a very unique character.
Oh, yes, absolutely. He's, he taps into that special pizza-like energy that, you know, so many other characters also, you know, tie into, like Samurai Pizza Cats, the Ninja Turtles, you know, that it's that primal pizza energy from beyond space and time.
What New York thrives on, primal pizza energy.
Oh, yeah, you're from New York, so you should all know about good pizza, because that's one of my dreams, to eat a good quality New York pizza.
I mean, there's plenty of it out here. I literally live right behind a pizza shop run by this Armenian guy. And he's, the place is literally called I Love New York Pizza. Because, I mean, New York, I don't know if it's like a chain or if every guy in my town decided that that's what they're going to name their pizza restaurant. Because I'm pretty sure they're all owned by different people. But the one near my house, very good. You know, like, I don't know what kind of pizza you have up there in Alaska, but... You know, and down here in New York, we like, you know, the thin, crispy crust, we fold it in half. I grew up eating anchovies on my pizza. That's what my thing was, up until, like, I was, like, I don't know, I think around when I was 10, when my dad dared me for my 10th birthday to drink a cup of anchovy juice for $20. I did, and I threw up in the parking lot of a pizza restaurant, but I think I've never had anchovies.
Ooh, I love anchovy. Anchovies is like my favorite.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm a sausage and pepperoni kind of guy.
Yeah, no, if they were ever to make a quote-unquote, like, Admiral pizza based on, like, the Admiral, it would more than likely have anchovies on it. It would probably have a mixture of, in my head, the Admiral pizza would have anchovies, pineapple, and green peppers.
Ooh. I don't know. There was a terrible pizza. I don't know. It would probably be something like super good. Maybe probably have like one like random thing on it that like nobody usually puts on it. Like, I mean, so I like my pizzas, as I said, sausage and pepperoni. I also like mushrooms on my pizza. Mm. That's a recent thing that I've been getting into is mushrooms.
Okay,
and then,
okay, here, this is what I imagine for a Terrifull pizza. Okay, this is what you got. Okay, you got a barbecue base, mozzarella cheese,
yeah.
Mushroom, shredded roast beef, reindeer sausage.
Oh my god.
Bacon. And, I don't know about, well, like pepperoni, why the hell not? And maybe with the drizzled with a little bit of hot sauce on top. That would, I think, would be the terrible pizza.
I think we're going to have to make that canon now.
Yeah, no, because I think the roast beef would get it, like, it would make it very primal, kind of like a wild
And, animal. You know, maybe some terrible the cat, maybe just, you know, since, you know, the cat, we could do rat meat on it as well. There's the unique thing.
Well, I don't know, rat meat on pizza sounds very New York-like.
I mean, we have plenty of rats out here, so. Hey, look, I mean, like, especially in, like, New York City, which I hope someday you go, Admiral, you will absolutely, like, lose your mind with the amount of different pizzas to try down there, but, like, New York City is known for a few things, and one of them is wraps, especially in the subway system. Like, so if you ever want to get wrap meat on a pizza, I'm sure they wouldn't have a hard time finding it for you.
Well, you know what, if I really want rat meat, let's be honest here, I could just eat a hot dog.
Yeah, you really could. I mean, you might have some other stuff mixed in there, but yeah, you could do a hot dog. I could
use my raccoon fix as well, so raccoon, cow, rat, I mean, you know, and only X amount of feces allowed legally, so.
I guess pizza is the underlying topic of the night, and I see that you are an avid pineapple on pizza enthusiast.
Oh, yes. No, I mean, I believe that eating whatever you want on your pizza is freedom, and discriminating against others for their pizza preferences is un-American, because some people just grow up with pineapple, and, like, they can't think of any other way, but some people get very offended by it, and, you know, I don't think you should really get offended by any kind of toppings, because you go anywhere across the world, and people eat different kind of toppings, so.
All right, so I can respect that decision, so let me get your thoughts on this. What about people who dip their pizza in the ranch?
Ooh, I like that. That's good.
Really?
Or what's really crazy one that you could do is that you do a ranch base with some mozzarella, and you put broccoli.
Broccoli?
Yeah, broccoli on pizza.
I've seen broccoli on pizza before. I've also seen a new development as of recently, strawberries on pizza. That's the next big thing coming around. Pineapple is getting close to the edge for me, but with strawberries, like, I don't know. Like, there's got to be a line that I like. Strawberries on pizza, they're two different flavors. They don't complement. Like,
call it me crazy, which I am. I'm thinking that a strawberry pizza would go really good with a white sauce. I don't know why.
A white sauce? Like an Alfredo sauce?
Yeah, like an Alfredo sauce. I don't know why. It'll probably go better than with a red sauce. I'm calling me crazy, but I think it would go better like that.
Well, I know the dessert pizzas can have, like, a strawberry jam as the base in place of the quote-unquote sauce. And I know that those are really hit or miss. Sometimes they're good. There used to be this pizza joint by where I used to live out in Utah, that was like a pizza buffet, and you could go up and you could, you know, request a bunch of random different toppings on pizza. Like, I did one that was goldfish and jalapenos at one point. But their big thing was, I think it was the only place in town that sold dessert pizzas.
Really good dessert pizzas.
I never understood the appeal of them. Like, it's like a novelty thing. Like, you try it once and yeah, I'll never have it again, in my mind, at least.
Well, I don't know. I think it's kind of like a nostalgic thing, because I would go to the buffet, and, you know, after you're done with your buffet, after you're done, like, eating all the cheese and your pepperoni, and you jump on the arcade machine, and you play World Champions 2, and some Metal Slug, and then after all that, you settle down with a little dessert pizza. So it's not necessarily, like, a thing you order yourself. It's just, like, it's just always, it's there for the dessert.
I hear you. There was a pizza place that I still go to now. It's about, I don't know, maybe half an hour from my house. It's called Paul's Pizza. And it's, I used to go there when I was a kid with my grandparents. And they always had they had, you know, like a regular pizza place, and then the back over by the bathrooms, they had three different arcade games. And as they broke, they rotated them out and whatnot. But the one that I always remembered growing up, well, they always had, when I was growing up, Marvel vs. Capcom, which I would always play. I would always flock to that.
I played that so much. Oh my god, I was just so, practically like I could have gone to college, but no, I played Marvel vs. Capcom.
They had that. They had. I want to say it was like a compilation cabinet from Namco. And I remember the one game that I would always play is Rally X.
That sounds like a racing game.
Yeah, the one where you collect the little flag.
Okay.
And then the last one that they always had was some sort of, like, Cabela's Big Hunt, like, in the corner that nobody played, so it was always super dusty.
Yeah.
But, it's a shame, because that's the only place that I've ever known to have a Marvel vs. Capcom arcade cabinet, like a original one. And it broke at some point, like, I want to say, like, 6 or so years ago, and I wasn't really into, like, the retro video game scene as I am now, so I always kind of like, I wish that I could have gotten that cabinet. Even broken, it would have been a nice hobby project to finish.
Yeah, you know, it's funny, at my school, I was walking by in the engineering department, and they had a handmade arcade cabinet with like a little, you know, like the buttons and all this, and it's all
wood
and everything. And, you know, I always wanted to do one of those. I was thinking about, for my next convention, getting an arcade cabinet and having a demo of Admiral Pizza, Dream Team Fighters, like, playing, or, I don't know, rigging it up so people could just play, like, Ninja Turtles, or, I don't know, just get people hanging around my booth or whatnot, I don't know.
I looked into for a while, because when I was still doing my games, we had one called Tough Coded, and it's basically like an arcade shoot-em-up, so we were in the process of, like, designing and figuring out, like, details for making an arcade cabinet for that, or something that I had seen that I always thought was really cool. I never got around to making it. Was this little briefcase. It was like a briefcase arcade cabinet, and, like, you opened it up, and you had, like, your controls on, like, one side of the briefcase, and then on the side that was flipped up, you would have the screen. And there was, like, yeah, and so you could always carry it around with you. That way, like, easily portable. So, like, hey, you guys want to try out my game? Cool. Open up the briefcase, plug the thing in, you go to town.
Yeah. Okay, so I got a question for you. Okay, so if Terrafall was an arcade cabinet, what would it play like?
Oh, it's funny you mentioned that, because I actually, there was a period of time for, I want to say about maybe 4 years when we were developing a Terrafall game. And I guess I'll give you what that was supposed to be. That'll kind of be what kind of answer your question. But it was a 2D hack and slash type game where you had Terrafall, you had his sword. It was kind of really inspired by like Sonic and Spark the Electric Jester, which is one of my favorite games of all time.
Mm-hmm.
And you kind of had like a few different like. You had, like, a world map, and you could go to different regions of the world and, like, save them from, like, regional dictators and stuff like that.
Regional dictators, like anti-pineapple pizza man.
is that the anti-pineapple pizza man? I'm kidding.
Well, I don't know. Maybe I'm thinking, I think at one point I'm going to have a story where Admiral Pizza liberates a country with some sort of dictator ruler who is very strictly anti-pineapple pizza.
Oh, your Admiral Pizza's getting political and is not just funny.
Well, no, Admiral Pizza's always has a little bit of political undertones with a little bit of inspiration from the Metal Gear Solid series.
I'll be completely honest. I know of the series. I've never actually sat down and played the games. I'm not into like that sort of spy stuff, believe it or not.
Okay, well, I would have to say the original Metal Gear Solid has had a very special place in my heart because the game takes place on a fictional island in Alaska.
Really?
Yeah. No, the plot of the game is that there's this fictional fictional island called Shadow Moses Island, and it's a nuclear waste disposal facility, but it's secretly a secret weapons lab for Metal Gear.
That was a good voice. Holy crap.
Why, thank you, thank you. So then, okay, so anyway, Solid Snake's twin brother takes over the base, and then, they take over the base, and then you gotta infiltrate the base, and you got to destroy Metal Gear, and it's really epic, and I don't know, like, a lot of people are like, oh, well, why is Metal Gear Solid, such a, like, you know, like a big, break, you know, an important game? And I have to say, it was probably one of the first games to have a cinematic-like plot, where it was like a movie. You know, because other games were, like, a good example would be, like, Final Fantasy, where they just couldn't quite get it. Like, you know, they had the text boxes, the dialogue and everything. It's like you're playing Legend of Zelda. Like, you had cinematic cutscenes and all this, but Metal Gear Solid is, like, the first video game to truly, like, play like you're, like, in a movie.
Yeah, no, I hear what you're saying. This is gonna sound bad, and I'm sure anybody watching this is gonna absolutely like ridicule me for this. But I'm a very casual gamer, so video games with like cinema level plots are kind of like a little bit of like a turnoff for me. Because like as good as a video game is, if I have to learn a bunch of random lore in order to fully appreciate the game, I'm probably not going to give it the time of day, and I probably shouldn't go back to playing Mario Kart. Mm. Like, that's my thought process. Now, if Mario Kart someday develops, like, a Marvel-type level lore, then I'll probably drop that, too. But for the foreseeable future, I don't see that. Except, the one exception for that is Admiral Pizza, Team Two Fighters. I will absolutely read the lore for that. Respect to the Admiral.
Yeah, no. Well, Admiral Pizza, Dream Team Fighters, I guess is not very lore-heavy per se, but I guess it's just fun to know a little bit about the characters and all that, and you can just get little nods and everything, like when you're going around the docks and you see Drac going about. So I don't know. So how much lore could you tolerate in a game? Like, let me give a good example. Like, Legend of Zelda, for instance, it's always different every game, but it still has a little bit of a lore. Like, for instance, there was this one part in Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild where, like, Breath of the Wild has, like, its own expansive lore. Like, they talk about the links before the other link, you know, and they talk about the other games and all that.
Yeah.
And there's, like, this one part where you go to this waterfall, and you're talking with, you're going to this waterfall, or it's, like, in the Zora area, and there's, like, the history of the Zora, and you can go and read all this crap. I was like, oh, fuck all this shit. I don't care. But there's other stuff that I found interesting. So, where do you draw the line? Like, how much lore can you take?
So, one of the games that I've been playing through, and granted, since, again, I'm, like, a casual gamer, it's, like, a very slow playthrough, is Mario and Rabbids, Kingdom Battle, Mario Rabbids Kingdom Battle, I think that's what it's called, and that's pretty, like, that has, like, you know, if you go in, you know who the Rabbids are, you don't need to know any of the Rayman lore, you know who Mario is, great, now you can focus on, like, the story at hand, you don't have to be like, oh, well, this connects to this, and this, blah, 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 you know, this ties into this, and, like, no, just, you know, beat up the Rabbids. Uh-huh, all right, go to the next game. Oh, Donkey Kong's fused with him? Let's go beat him up, too. Like, you know, at the end of the day, like, if the story is just pretty rounded off and it's kind of just, like, presented to me, like, this is going to sound like I just need to be spoon-fed, but if the story is just pretty much self-contained, I can draw the line there. If it's something that is, like, you know, requiring, even like some of the Sonic lore really gets out there after a while, but it's just, that's probably where I draw the line, is somewhere around like Mario and Rabbit Kingdom Battle, where it's just like, you have a story, that's it, don't worry about anything else, all you need to know is that there's rabbits and there's Mario.
Interesting. Okay, so here we got a few more minutes for our next guest. So let's talk the crossover for a couple minutes. So you and Smacky and some other very talented artists all got together and decided to do an epic crossover with we're all teaming up, all of our comic characters teaming up against a entity called Black Death, who is very omnipotent. He sees the big picture. And there's rumors of a sequel coming up. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that for the audience?
Yes, so there's potentially two sequels. One a shorter one than the other. The second sequel is a relatively recent development, and I don't want to give any spoilers away because it pertains to stuff that's going to happen in the last couple of issues of the crossover, which we are working on right now. So Crisis on Infinite Co., for anybody listening that doesn't know, is, as Admiral said, a big crossover with about 12 different series from the Howzy webcomic catalog, including Admiral Pizza. We've been doing this for about a year at this point. We've put out 4 out of the 6 issues. We're on the last 2 right now. And we're really hoping to have everything done by Christmas. That way we can look into printing up physical copies for, you know, like Christmas and whatnot. But in terms of the sequel, the actual sequel to the crossover, tentatively titled Chaos on Infinite Co., will explore sort of like amalgam characters, so kind of like mashup characters.
That's what I'm really excited for, because I'm looking forward to introducing one of my characters who is a mashup of Stardust, Admiral Pizza, and Tad Danger, called Tad Danger Star, a.k.a. Or is it like a Tad Danger Star, a.k.a. Admiral Pizza Dust?
Well, I like Admiral Pizza Dust a little bit more, I'm not gonna lie.
Or is it, Danger Pizza Dust?
Yeah, there you go, that sounds good.
Or is it Admiral Danger Dust or something? Like, yeah, there's a lot of interesting combinations. Alright, here. So, we are gonna gear up for a commercial break and get ready for our next guest. So, let's get a cheer from the audience.
Thank you, Admiral, so much for your time.
All right, I'll talk to you later, man. All right, peace.